welcome to the USA. We made it through Boston Airport and all the customs and everything else going on there. Unfortunately, Charles Johnson, who's a program director of TCI Cable in Andover, picked us up. And if Charles hadn't been there, I think we'd still be in the airport now. But good evening, Charles.
Good evening.
How are you doing?
Oh, wonderful. It's good to have you all here.
Yeah. Now, Ian Carr, the mayor of Andover in the UK, has been making the headlines here. He's in the local paper, which we'll show you later. But we're heading north out of Boston now, aren't we? On the road... What road are we on?
Route 1
north. And how far from Andover now?
We're about 15 minutes, which is about 15-20 miles from Andover.
So how's the mayor's visit from Andover, England, gone down? Here he got interviewed by the local TV station.
He was. I heard stories. I didn't get to see the story myself, but he was very well received, and the children of Andover particularly took a liking to him because he visited several of their classrooms and told them some stories about Andover, England, and they were very interested about their sister city.
That's great. I see he's presented them with a cannonball from the Battle of Andover, which we're going to find out about.
Interesting. I'd like to know how he got it through customs.
Yeah, how did you get that through customs? We had enough trouble getting the camera through. But anyway, as you say, we're about 15 minutes away. What's this sort of area? Is it an industrial area or farming or what are they doing in this part of the country?
Well, right now we're on Route 1, which is primarily a lot of stores, a lot of restaurants, a lot of hotels. It's a large shopping road, basically. And once we get off of here, we're going to go into a more rural area where there are farms and small businesses. Actually, we're right nestled in a very high industrial area, which is the Route 128, which is on the other side of us here. That's where a lot of high-tech industrial and defense companies are located.
Okay, great. Well, we're going to go on north, I guess, out of Boston towards Andover. And we'll see all you viewers in Andover, in Massachusetts, in about 15 minutes. So we'll see you later. Thanks for watching the show. Bye for now. Well, welcome to this very special edition of Town TV. This week, live from Andover, Massachusetts. Claire and I have come over to meet with our mayor of the Test Valley, Councillor Ian Carr, and his wife Beryl, haven't we?
We have. It's very exciting. We're also going to be watching George Bush doing a speech.
Oh, that's right. George Bush is here tonight in Andover, Massachusetts, and he's going to be presenting, Ian Carr is going to be presenting him with some memento of the visit.
It really is. It's very exciting. The whole town is alive with their 350th anniversary of the town. And later on, we're going to find out about the Indian who sold it to them for a pound, apparently.
Yes, but he wish he hadn't. But, yeah. Also, we're going to meet all sorts of people. We're going to meet with the town manager, Buzz. Great name, that is. Yeah. We're going to meet with the fire department, and we're going to meet with the police department.
We're going to be trying white asparagus from the Andover Inn.
We'll be doing all sorts of things, so...
It's very exciting.
It's very exciting. So just keep watching this wonderful edition of the show this week. So we'll see you later. I don't know where, but we'll see you later.
Bye.
Bye. We've come all the way across the Atlantic to find Councillor Ian Carr, the mayor of the Test Valley. And where is he?
He's playing tennis.
He's... playing tennis at the Rolling Green Tennis Club here in Andover, Massachusetts. So we're going to go and find him, actually, before he does anything else today.
Yes, come on.
And it's raining still, so we'll see you in the tennis. Well, here we are backstage, so to speak, at the tennis court. So what we're going to do is go through these beige curtains and...
try and find him.
That's right. A bit of This Is Your Life, almost, I think, isn't it? So
watch the tennis balls.
Here we go. Big surprise. Andover to Andover.
Good shot.
Mr. Mayor, what a splendid shot. How nice to see you. All the way from Andover to Andover.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's marvellous, isn't it?
How's it going?
Borders off duty.
How's it going? I hear you've been working so hard this last week.
It's been brilliant. Last weekend was fabulous, yeah.
All these photographs in the local press?
Yeah. Well, we visited schools and we cooked pancakes and we visited the senior centres and... What else do we do? Crikey, we've done all sorts of things. We went to listen to Harriet Beecher Stowe, we went to the parade.
Yeah.
We made presentations. We on their table for the selectmen.
Yeah.
So we took part in their council meeting and that was on television. Oh, the first few days were whirlwind, but it was great.
Absolutely fantastic. So, yeah. And still the highlight of the visit to come, I guess.
Yes, sure. I mean, inauguration dinner with President Bush.
Well, we've got a little surprise for you this afternoon. We've been invited to the Andover Inn, which is a sensational building on the Phillips Academy, and they want to cook you some white asparagus.
Oh, that sounds really nice. Never seen white asparagus. I don't think it's normally green when I eat it.
Well, the owner's Dutch, and he flies it in especially. And the chef's going to cook us some, especially this afternoon.
Oh, that'll be lovely. We've been to the Andover, and you're right, it's a super place. Yeah. We had a good evening there the other night after the selectmen meeting.
Yeah.
Something we don't do after our council meetings, perhaps we ought to.
Explain a selectman. What is a selectman, by the way?
Well, the selectmen are elected to run the town. Mm-hmm. There's five selectmen, of which the selectmen themselves elect a chairman for a year. Mm-hmm. And they run for office every 3 years, and they run the town. A budget of $72 million.
It's incredible, isn't it?
Yeah. But they run education and fire and police and everything. I think we gave a licence to a taxi cab when we were there, and plus we banned for funny strings. So they run all...
Oh, I read that in the paper.
Yeah, right. All diverse things they look after.
Yeah, we're going to go and try and talk to the Andover Townsman, which is the local paper, yeah. Also the fire department, and also the police department, I hope.
Yeah, well, we had breakfast with the Rotary, as I said this morning, yeah. And the chief of police was there, and Chuck Manane from the fire department was there as well. So Chuck brought me down here just a minute ago. So
splendid. Well, it's good to see you enjoying yourself and doing such a wonderful service to the community.
Well, we do our best. I say it's like home from home here. The people have been so welcoming that it's great. Yeah. I'll be back, even if it's not as mayor, I'll be back.
So will I. I think it's absolutely brilliant. Yeah. Anyway, thanks for talking to us, and we'll see you later at the Andover Inn.
Welcome to Durrington. It's not far from Andover, it's not far from Salisbury. And we've come along today because we've been invited along to an open day. We get a lot of people who phone in to our show with pet inquiries, so we may do a feature on this in the future. Phone in and let us know if you want us to do that. But we're coming along to talk to the people who run this clinic, and it's very inventive and very new modern ideas they got here. Well, look who's here. It's Phamie. I thought if it had something to do with animals, you would be here.
Well, as you know, I love animals. You may think I'm big and tough and hard, and I am, but show me a little fluffy animal and I go all soggy inside.
I know what happened. You heard us mention something about this yesterday in the office, and you turned up just to see the animals, didn't you?
Certainly did, and I'm going to go off and find them any minute.
Okay, well, I'm going off to find Craig. I'm going to do an interview with him, and you're going to have a look around and see what's happening here.
Certainly am. Well, I've come along to the ward, and I'm here with Louise, who's a nurse here, and she's just about to feed Titch. She's not very well. Poor little thing. Very poorly, and having her first meal of the day. She's really excited. Oh, bless, isn't she beautiful? Louise, hello. What's wrong with Titch here?
Titch has got pancreatitis, and she's been in for a few days now. We did some blood tests initially, and she hasn't been able to eat it or drink anything for a couple of days, and we've just slowly started her back on fluids and a bland diet.
Okay, I'm gonna say hello to Titch, because she looks beautiful. Hello. Hello, beautiful. She just had her dinner. What's this around her neck here?
This is what we call a jugular catheter, and that's where we go for fluids.
Yeah.
We put them up around in the jugular because the lung don't get so tangled up in them. as if, and also she hasn't got much leg to put
oh,
on
no,
in.
No, so she's short little legs.
It's a convenient place to put them, and so she can get her necessary fluids.
So how long until Titch is better?
Well, she's doing well. She's kept all her food and everything down today, so hopefully next week.
Brilliant. So how long have you been working here, Louise?
7 months now. I haven't been here that long. I've been nursing for about 6.5 years, and I've moved to this practice to start my training next year to qualify. Thank you.
Must be so satisfying when an animal comes in and it's not very well, to see it bouncing out again and happy back to its
own. Very rewarding. Yeah. It's what makes it all worthwhile, all the long nights.
So I understand you live in Southampton and you travel down every day.
Yeah.
A long way to come, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
So it's real dedication for you, real dedication. So you'll be fully trained by next year?
No, it takes a couple of years.
Right.
But I'll be starting officially next year, and then I should be at the college next September. Do my first year exams, so see how they go.
Excellent. So we'll say goodbye to poor little Titch and let him have a rest, because he's not very well at all, is he? What's the most unusual animal you've ever had in here?
We have had sort of snakes and iguanas,
oh,
that sort of thing.
Snakes. Is there any animal you don't mind?
Spiders.
Have you ever had a spider in here?
Not yet, no. I've never seen one yet. So
dreading the day.
Lucky, yeah.
Great. So thanks for talking to us, Louise, and good luck with all your training. And good luck to you, Titch, and I hope you get better soon. You're beautiful. And we'll see you later.
Craig.
Hello, Tony.
Nice to meet you.
Welcome to our hospital.
Well, thanks for inviting us here today, because it's a wonderful place, and it's a very, very... It's different to all the veterinary things I've known from the past. I haven't been to one for a long time.
It's good of you to say, but the do today is to celebrate National Pet Week, and we're having an open day to... In the celebration of Animal Pet Week, or National Pet Week. Our approach here was to not so much provide absolute specialist excellence in each particular field, but to bring good, solid, affordable veterinary medicine to the average family and their pet. People sometimes underestimate what can be done for their pets should something go wrong, should they get ill or should they have an accident, and how much it's going to cost. There's no NHS in veterinary medicine. All the developments here are funded entirely by monies paid by the clients that come through the front door.
Yeah. Can I say thank you for inviting me here today, and can we come back and see you and
we would
keep
be
up to date with you?
To have you back again. Thank you very much.
And it would be nice to come over and see your Salisbury clinic as well.
Well, I'm sure Howard would be looking forward to that.
Thanks very much indeed, Craig.
Well, in my childhood, I always wanted to be a doctor. I never did make it, but now I'm having almost second best here. I'm assisting Sue, who's head nurse at the veterinary clinic, on an operation. Sue, who are we operating on here?
Right, this is our Panda. I'm afraid he's not very well.
What's wrong with him?
Right, okay, well, we're doing our best to monitor him, yes. He's coming for an operation on his tummy.
Bless him.
Okay.
So we're in the pets operating theatre here at the clinic. How similar is this to a human operating theatre?
Okay, well, it's very, very similar. As you can see, we have, this would normally be very sterile operating drapes, sterile equipment, instruments over there to operate with. We also have a breathing tube down the trachea of the patient.
Trachea, excuse me for being silly, but what's a trachea?
Right, okay, it's a windpipe.
Oh, right, okay.
Okay, that helps the patient to breathe while they're under the anaesthetic, which is attached onto the anaesthetic machine, which keeps them asleep while the surgeon is operating. We also have lots of different monitors for them. The monitor that you can see down here is monitoring their ECG, which is the electrical activity of the heart. Mm-hmm. And we can also print out this trace, as you can see on the picture above. If we have any problems with them during the anaesthetic, then we can do a printout and interpret the results afterwards to see if they need to have any treatment.
Mm-hmm.
The monitor also measures their pulse and their respiration, sounds alarms to us if anything goes wrong. But at the same time, we are also actually physically watching them, watching their breathing, monitoring their heart and their colour of their mucous membranes to make sure that they're going okay under the anaesthetic.
Mm-hmm.
And we also have this monitor here, which monitors the pulse again, which is the bottom reading, and also the oxygen saturation level of the blood while they're under the anaesthetic.
So what kind of operations take place here?
Right, okay. Well, we do a number of different things, and we do quite a lot of routine operations, such as spaying and castrating, the neutering side of it. We also do orthopaedic surgery. We sometimes have to do exploratory operations when we just open up their abdomen to see if there's anything going wrong in there that we haven't been able to sort of detect by, you know, just palpating their abdomen. We do sort of operations on their eyes, their legs, a number of different things. It's basically on similar sort of situations to human surgery.
Mm-hmm. So what do you do during an operation?
Right, okay. Well, basically what I've said with the monitors, the nurse is here to hand any instruments to the vet. We've put all the instruments out. We wear our hats and masks as you would do in human surgery and have their gloves. But our main sort of job really is to monitor the patient under anaesthetic so that the vet can concentrate on the actual operation. We make sure they're breathing, that their heart's going fine, that their colour's good, they're getting enough oxygen. So we might have to adjust the amount of inhalation anaesthetic that they're actually getting into it. Mm-hmm. And to hand the vet all his suture materials, his needles, any other instruments that he might need that he hasn't got to hand at the time.
So what was the most unusual operation you've ever had to perform here?
Well, we did have a little Labrador puppy that had got a bit carried away with what he'd eaten, and we had to remove a number of Dolly's heads, a couple of handkerchiefs, and half the dustbin out of his stomach, which wasn't very nice. But Labradors have a tendency to eat things they shouldn't. So
he was all right after you took the doll's heads out.
Yes, it taught him a lesson, I think, not to eat too many things that he shouldn't do. Yes. Brilliant. And we also have our autoclave over there, which we...
Autoclave? Now, show me, what is an autoclave?
That's our sterilisation unit.
Looks like a microwave.
We open it up in here, we pop the instruments into the tray, close the door, and then it builds up to a pressure with steam, and then the temperature goes up and it actually kills all the bugs on the instruments and the drapes so that they're completely sterile when we use them again. The next
so everything here is very, very carefully monitored and controlled.
Yeah, it's very sterile, very carefully monitored. There's always a nurse in here with them while they're under anaesthetic, and then they follow them through into the ward while they're coming round from the anaesthetic as well.
Brilliant. Okay, well, thank you ever so much for talking to us today, Sue. And good luck on your next operation. And I hope this poor little chap here pulls through.
Okay.
We wish him luck.
In the first prize in 7 8 is Oliver Irving, who threw a pet pie into the chiller.
One of England's oldest racecourses is on your doorstep, with meetings during the summer months, including evening races. Facilities are available for serious punters and those who race for fun. Children under 16 accompanied by an adult are admitted free of charge, and for the youngsters, a creche, bouncy castle and a range of supervised entertainment is available during certain meetings. Party bookings are available with generous discounts for 10 or more guests, including corporate entertainment facilities. Whatever your requirements, a splendid day's entertainment is assured at Salisbury Racecourse. Of course! Phone now for details on Salisbury 326 461.
Westbury Homes provide a comprehensive choice of quality 2, 3 and 4 bedroom homes at two developments in Andover. The Hedgerows near Charlton and Celtic Fields off Salisbury Road. Standard features include double glazing, UPVC windows, fitted smoke alarms and much more. Westbury Homes have many special offers, all backed by Westbury's customer care. So phone now for the Hedgerows on Andover 352207, Celtic Fields 350188.
Don't miss the Middle Wallop International Air Show in June, which promises to be better than ever. On Friday the 14th, Music in the Air will be performed by the London Philharmonic Youth Orchestra, accompanied by a choreographed flying display. The air show opens to the public on Saturday the 15th and Sunday the 16th. featuring the Army Air Corps' massed approach of 100 helicopters and flying displays of classic aircraft. But there is much more to enjoy, including a children's fun fair, a trader's exhibition, as well as free car parking. Phone now for full information on Andover 782 086.
Why don't you get fit for business at the Andover Leisure Centre? We have the most up-to-date equipment in the area. Our fitness experts are always at hand to guide you every step of the way. We also have an exclusive ladies-only gym. So why don't you come down and see for yourself at the Andover Leisure Centre? Or why not call us now on Andover 324144. That's Andover 324144.
Well, here we are, as promised, on the steps of Andover Town Hall, I guess you'd call it. They call it the Andover Town Offices. And we've come to see Buzz Stapasinski. That's a mouthful.
Stapasinski.
You say it very well indeed. And he is the town manager. Or I suppose, as we would say back in Andover, the chief executive. But we've come to see Buzz. Hopefully he'll grant us an audience this afternoon.
I do hope so, yeah.
Hopefully, yeah. So we're going to go inside to see him. So see you later. Okay, we're with the town manager of Andover, Massachusetts. Good afternoon, Buzz. Thanks for inviting us to your office.
My pleasure, Alan.
It's very, very kind of you indeed to invite us to this lovely town of Andover. And it's very, very important. You've, since 1646, it's 350 years to 1996. So what's happened in that time?
Oh, we've had an exciting history. I don't know where to start. But in the beginning, Andover was a huge, huge community. Probably about 60 square miles, and the community had a varied history, ups and downs, all that. But in about 1850, the internal differences reached a head, and the community split in half. And so now we have Andover and North Andover, and it was basically religious, economic, social, cultural, and probably family differences that divided the North Parish from the South Parish. The North Church and the North Parish went on their own way, and the South Parish, South Church, went on its own way. And so the North Parish took the name North Andover, and the South Parish just took the name Andover. Our history from then to now has been that of a lot of commercial progress. We're the home of Hewlett-Packard Medical Systems Division, company called PictureTel that does video teleconferencing, and Gillette, razor people,
right.
Although you wouldn't know it by me,
right.
And the Raytheon, the folks that brings us the Patriot missile, and in fact, last time President Bush was in Andover was after the Gulf War. He came here to the Raytheon plant, and they're our largest employer. They employ about 5,000 people, and came to congratulate them on their efforts on the work on the Patriot missile. What we'll find out tomorrow at the reception and the party and the speech we'll hear from President Bush is that there were seven presidents of the United States who came through Andover for one reason or another,
really?
Either to attend Phillips Academy, mm-hmm. like President Bush did, or to address Phillips Academy or the Andover Theological Seminary, or to pass through the town of Andover for one reason or another.
Yeah.
So we're quite proud of our connection with Phillips and with, you know, with President Bush.
Tell me a little bit about the Phillips Academy. It's obviously world famous.
Well, it is world famous, and it has about 1,250 students.
Mm-hmm.
Many of them are day students, mm-hmm. so they do draw upon the community itself. I think about 200 students are from the town of Andover itself. So they've got about 1,000 young people living on campus, and they come from all over the world, all walks of life. It's extremely diverse. They have a strong connection with with the Soviet Union or the former Soviet Union countries, so they receive a number of students and they do exchanges there, as well as every possible country in the world is involved in the campus in one way or another.
We're just off to the Andover Inn, which is on the campus, so right. We're going off to meet our mayor, the mayor of Andover in the Test Valley, who right. You've been so graciously entertaining. Yes. Thank you very much.
He's been there a couple of times. Yes. We were there on Monday night after the selectmen's meeting.
Yep. So I think I'm going to cook him white asparagus. That's the owner, Henry's speciality, I believe.
Yeah. So Henry's Dutch.
That's right.
And he's from the Netherlands. And he's very very much into asparagus.
That's right.
He has an asparagus festival every year, brings in world experts on asparagus. Oh, so we have a lot of fun.
Great. On a personal front, what's it like doing your job in this office there in Andover? Well, do you enjoy it?
I do, yes. I wouldn't be here if I didn't enjoy it. It's challenging, yeah. And it's every day is varied. I've been here 6 enjoyable years, and every day is different. Every day is exciting, whether I'm working on the town budget or negotiating with the police or the fire or one of the town's unions, or listening to citizens with complaints about, I don't know, potholes or parking tickets or whatever it may happen to be, or meeting you folks or meeting the mayor and his wife and entertaining people from abroad. So it's a fun job. No 2 days are the same.
Okay, well, thanks very much again for inviting us across. It's absolutely splendid. And I hope to see you at the dinner on Saturday night, tomorrow night.
That'll be fun.
Okay. Thanks very much indeed.
Have a good stay.
Yeah, thank you.
Hi, I'm here at the Andover Fire Department with Deputy Bush. Hello, Deputy.
How do you do?
Hi, nice to meet you. We've been having a chat about one of the first things that struck me in Andover is that all the houses are actually constructed of wood, or the vast majority of them are. Does that affect how many fires you have here?
Well, it's not a cause of the fires, but the wood construction, of course, is combustible. And should a fire occur, then obviously it's going to contribute to the fire itself, yeah.
And you were saying earlier that you actually cover the area of Lawrence as well, which has a different population from Andover, and a lot more of your fires are there. Is that true?
Well, in the past few years, yes, we've had a lot of mutual aid calls over to Lawrence there. They have a lot of older construction, a lot of close to call three deckers in their wood construction. And they've had a problem with set fires, arson fires, that we've responded to quite a bit to that community, yeah.
I mean, the houses really are beautiful over here, but you also have the main roads, the main routes very close to here. Do you find you're going out to those a lot?
Yes, we run the ambulance in town. We run right now 2 ambulances, and because of our physical layout of Route 495 and 93, the junctions of them, and the amount of traffic we have on those, we do quite a few calls out there with the ambulances and auto extrication and car fires and that type of thing, yeah.
Yeah, because back home in England, we actually have our ambulances based at hospitals, not in the same department, but you actually run ambulances out of here as well as the fire.
Yes. Yeah.
Now, this is the bit I've really been looking forward to. Can you explain what's what and basically run me through what happens when you get a call?
Okay, well, this is a new pump that we just put in service a few weeks ago. Actually, the main pump panel is mounted right up on top here. This here is the receiving end. If they carry the hose and back when they go to the hydrant and they stretch from the hydrant to the fire scene, they'll take the hose and tie it into the pump, and then they can have discharge lines off of this here. They take other lines off. There's a large, they call it deck gun on top here. That can distribute.
Do you actually have any water in here, or you have to have a hydrant?
Yeah, no. This one here carries 750 gallons of water.
That's pretty impressive, I suppose, because if you're on motorways or something, you have to have some water.
Yes, right on the highway, like I said, we have you have these lines here that they can take off. There's a line in front there. We have also the capability of stretching another hand line from the back. We have this 750 gallons, which is a good initial fire attack until they can get a more continuous water supply.
They really are very impressive vehicles. Fantastic. Thank you very much for talking to us. And I do hope that none of these beautiful houses in Andover burned out. I'm here with firefighter Mason. I'm about to start up the motor. Now, firefighter Mason, please can I put on the blue light?
It's the down button here.
Yeah.
Okay. It's moving now.
Woo! Noise? Just a quick noise.
Alright.
How do you do the noise?
Just turn that button right there, just turn it one up. One more. All the
way around, go ahead. Okay. Okay, I won't deafen everyone by doing that too much. That was really good fun. Can you take me, let's turn it off. Do I do this?
That turns it off.
Cool, okay.
This is what they call a pump.
And I'm going to take the hat off. I've looked far too silly enough now. Now, tell me what all these buttons do here.
This is what we call a pump. What this does is this particular truck brings water with it and has the capability of pumping out of a hydrant. So if we go to a structure fire or a car fire or a brush fire, this truck, main purpose is to pump water. We have 750 gallons on the truck, which is what all these levers are for. You put those and what happens is the trunk has the capability of pumping water. Then we can go around to the back, and the panel there has all the gates and the valves to fill the hoses with water. And that's basically what the truck does.
It's very, very impressive. And I'm sure ours at home don't have all these nice, new, shiny toys. You've got, what's this, a torch here?
Yeah, just pull that out.
And that.
It's one of the lights that the men take into the buildings with them.
And they've got one by each seat.
That's a radio that they take with them.
Walkie-talkie.
Right.
This is a gadget person's dream, this thing. Thank you very much for showing us around. Nice to meet you. Bye-bye. Oh, this is fun. Go to it. We're fighting fires. Woo! Fantastic. Just call me if you've got a fire. I'll sort it out for you, no problem.
Hello, this is Richard Thompson with a roundup of local news from the Andover Advertiser and the Salisbury Journal. Used hypodermic needles dumped at Galahad Close have put children at risk, claimed two worried Andover mums. Parents are being urged to warn youngsters about the danger of picking up syringes after at least 15 were found at a popular play spot last weekend. Mum Vicky Humphreys faces an agonising 3-month wait to see if her 6-year-old son Daniel, who accidentally pricked himself on one, has picked up any infection. Don't touch these things yourself. Telephone us immediately and try to keep people away from them, said Council Environment Officer Roger Wilkin. Andover cricket fans were knocked for six this week when the world's greatest batsman, Brian Lara, visited Andover. The West Indian star signed autographs for an hour and a half in sports kit on Tuesday afternoon. I've totally enjoyed being here and the response has been excellent, said Brian. Callous bag snatchers mugged a middle-aged local woman in the subway at the top of Union Street just before 9 a.m. on Monday morning. Attacked from behind, she had her walking crutch kicked away and two men made off with her handbag as she slumped to the floor. If you have any information or saw anything to help inquiries, please contact Detective Sergeant Paul Taylor on Andover 324 311. Budding models who want the chance to wear top London designer fashions are needed. A high-quality fashion show being held in Tidworth on 14th June needs tall, slim men and women to take to the catwalk. Call Sonia Carr on 01980 847 870 for details. Youngsters' imaginations and their limbs were stretched during the joint TSB and County Council's Arts in Schools project. Pupils from Shipton Bellinger, Overwallop, Hurstbourne Tarrant, John Hanson and Roman Way all explored the medium of dance. Schools enjoyed performances from true professional dance companies before artists ran workshops for them. Luggershaw could be a revitalised centre for jobs if a local district and county councillor gets his way. Andrew Edwards is urging the local council to back a scheme to reincarnate Luggershaw Armoured Vehicle Depot. He wants studies carried out to find out if the site could be transformed into an industrial centre. Local beauties out there are being urged not to miss their chance to be the 1996 Andover Carnival Queen. Entry is open to girls between 16 and 30 who live within 10 miles of Andover. To take part, turn up at Waverley Hall Studios on 25th May between 10 and 12 a.m. with an Andover Advertiser entry form and have your picture taken professionally. The drug ecstasy is readily available in Salisbury, and more than three quarters of young people say they would not find it difficult to buy it, according to a shock report released today. But 73% said they had never taken it, and nearly two-thirds said they were put off after the death of Essex teenager Leah Betts. The random survey carried out by Salisbury radio and journalism student Steve Cheney reveals that 60% of 17 to 21-year-olds have tried drugs including cannabis, LSD and heroin. Plans by Salisbury College to sack some 200 part-time lecturers and re-employ them through an agency have been branded draconian by the Salisbury branch of the University and College Lecturers Union. But the college says the action has been forced upon them by European equal pay legislation. Controversial plans by Salisbury's Dean and Chapter to turn tennis courts in the Close into a permanent car park have been rejected by Salisbury councillors. Now they are to hold fresh talks with the cathedral authorities to try and find a solution to parking problems in the medieval Close. The Royal was put back into Wilton Carpet Factory last week when the Duke of Kent paid a visit. The Duke also performed the official opening of a new factory on Salisbury's Dolphin Trading Estate and was taken on a tour of Shellwork Industries, where 32 of the 36 strong staff are disabled. Youngsters robbed an elderly Wilton man as he helped them search for their ball. It's thought one of the boys went into the home of the 75-year-old pensioner while he helped the other look for the ball in his garden. A £50 ring and about £10 in cash was stolen. Sport. And swimmer Margaret Wilkinson of Salisbury Amateur Swimming Club struck gold at the Great Britain Masters Swimming Championships held in Sheffield. She took gold in the 50-metre and 100-metre breaststroke and narrowly missed making it a hat-trick when she came in second in the 200-metre breaststroke. And finally, two pets found themselves in the doghouse last week after they put through a 999 call and brought the emergency services tearing to their doorstep in Victoria Road. The operator feared someone had collapsed when she heard heavy breathing on the end of the line. Owner Carol Galpin was called home from her job, and she and police entered the flat to find the two dogs listening fascinated to the voice on the phone. That's all for now. More news from the Andover Advertiser and the Salisbury Journal next week.
When you visit the Video Game Centre in Endless Street, Salisbury, you'll enter a whole new world of experience. The centre is the leading software specialist in the area. From edutainment to games, you'll find it all here and on many different platforms. The Sony PlayStation, Sega Saturn, Super Nintendo, Sega Mega Drive, PC, CD-ROM and more. From Doom to Encarta's 96, from Dawling, Kindersley to Command & Conquer. And we operate a rental scheme. So why not talk to Kevin or Sarah for first-class advice at the Video Game Centre in Endless Street, Salisbury? Or give us a ring on Salisbury 412244. That's Salisbury 412244.
KJM Doors, Windows and Conservatories. KJM have moved to superb purpose-built showrooms at Milan Business Centre. Whatever your requirements, state-of-the-art technology, high safety standards, a bespoke service and the warmest welcome awaits you at KJM. On display are 13 types of opaque, plain and coloured windows in modern and traditional styles. The KJM fear-free range of doors, windows and conservatories are equipped with safety glass as standard. So don't delay, call us now on Andover 359 355.
Jungle Jangle, the wildest indoor adventure land, invites all young explorers under the age of 11 to enjoy the challenges of the Amazon Trail. Specially designed, the Jungle Playground means that even the youngest can explore in a safe and secure environment. We're open 7 days a week from 9:30 to 5:30. Jungle Jungle, Westway, Woolworth Industrial Estate, Andover. For more information, call us now on 01 264 336360.
Hello, I'm Eddie Neggs, Lex Vauxhall dealer principal in Salisbury. Thinking of buying a car in 1996? Come and see us at Southampton Road. Or, for any of your further motoring requirements, go to our service department in Brunel Road, Churchill's Industrial Estate.
I feel I should be on a chair when I'm talking to Norman Ray. Norman, you remember, came in last week. Oh, welcome back to the studio, by the way. Still got jet lag, but never mind. Norman came in last week to publicise this great event, which is in aid of the Wessex Hospice Trust. And the event is at the British Oak in Smanel. When is it, Norman?
What we're actually doing, we've had to make some changes to it because of the response. We are still presenting the cheque for last year's event. That's on the 26th at the British Oak in Smanel. And Cllr disease is still going along. He will still be receiving the cheque. However, what we are doing this...
However, the big build-up coming now. Go on.
However, what we're going to do this year is that we've been offered alternative premises for the launch of this summer's initiative, this summer's event. Out in Sutton Scotney, where the hospice has been built, next to that is Barton Stacey, and there is a pub called the Swan in Barton Stacey.
Remember that name.
And on the 26th also, we are moving the event, which was going to be at the British Oak, across to Swan.
It's going global. This event is getting huge.
There will be a barbecue. Now, that will start at 4 o'clock, and likewise, there will be music, which will be still crazy. They will have their roadshow there, and we will also have a local band. So that's 4 o'clock at the Swan in Barton Stacey.
4 o'clock, Swan in Barton Stacey. I know it's getting complicated. It's going global. It's going to be on Town TV. 4 o'clock, the Swan at Barton Stacey, and
4 o'clock, the Swan. Which date?
Which date was that? 26th of May. Let's Steve the cameraman, because he's going to be there, you see. 26th of May. That's a Sunday. Sunday, 26th of May.
After church. At Sunday the 26th at 4 o'clock, but the time has changed with the British Oak. It is 7 o'clock when the cheque has been presented, and the barbecue and the music event is at Swan from 4 o'clock.
There are shuttle buses running backwards and forwards. It's a bit like Gatwick and Heathrow, isn't it?
That's right. Well, we're certainly getting them out anyway. But it's important that we do mention, a lot has to do with the fact that the hospice has been built within half a mile of this of these premises, so we felt it was quite suitable. Yeah. And we'll be announcing this summer's event, which is going to take place in June as well.
Well, it's a fantastic cause. It's going to be a great event in June, but this is just the launch of the event. It's going to be great food that day. They've got a great barbecue. We'll be playing. Yes. You'll be there, won't you?
Yes, I'll be. I won't be playing, but I'll be there.
You'll be playing. I'm sure you'll be playing. That's right. So anyway, be there. Be there on the 26th of May. It's a Sunday. It's Bank Holiday Sunday, so you haven't got to get up the next day. Be there at both those venues. We'll put them up on screen now so you know all about it. It's a great cause. We need your support. Thank you, Norman. Okay,
thank you. See you there.
Okay, bye for now. Well, we're in the very grand surroundings of the Andover Inn, and we're with the Mayor of the Test Valley, Councillor Ian Carr. You were here earlier in the week, is that right?
We were here on Monday, Alan. Yes, we were having a drink and a chat. Very nice, too.
It's a beautiful place, isn't it?
It is. Very smart. And on a lovely campus.
It's absolutely beautiful. Phillips Academy in the background.
Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely stunning. And we're with Henry, the owner. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. How are you?
Thanks for inviting us.
You're welcome.
So, you've got a wonderful reputation in these parts, and probably worldwide. The Andover Inn's very famous. Mm-hmm. And how long have you been here?
I've been at the Andover Inn for 20 years.
20 years?
Mm-hmm.
And you're not American, are you?
No, I'm a Dutchman. But I became an American citizen in 1978.
How do you pronounce your surname?
Broekhoff.
Broekhoff, that's right.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So, but you're telling me you do something very interesting in the way of food. It's a white asparagus, is that right?
Well, the Andover Inn is a restaurant and a hotel. Mm-hmm. We also have hotel rooms upstairs. Mm-hmm. And in order to keep the public aware of the existence of the Andover Inn, it's always a good idea to have some specialties. And one of our specialties that we're already doing for 20 years is on Sunday nights we serve an Indonesian rijsttafel. Mm-hmm. And also in the months of May and June, we serve for about 8 weeks, we serve fresh white asparagus flown in from the Netherlands. Mm-hmm. White asparagus are absolutely and completely unknown in this country. And the first year we used up about 700 pounds flown in from the Netherlands.
Really?
And last year, the fourth year, we did over 1,200 pounds in 8 weeks. And so we hope to beat 1,200 pounds this year.
So does Mr. Bush come and eat your asparagus?
Mr. Bush has not come for the white asparagus yet, but he is a trustee of Phillips Academy.
Yes.
And in that capacity, between 1976 and 1980, when I was started here in 1976, he used to come here four times a year as a trustee for trustee meetings. And when he became vice president in 1980, he did not come anymore, but he has been here several times for speeches or important meetings, and he always makes it his business to come in and say hello to me.
Are you enjoying yourself, Ian? You've been here now a week and a bit.
It's been marvelous. I've really enjoyed it. Yeah. Yeah. It's been like coming home. I mean, people have been so friendly and so welcoming.
That's the thing I've felt. The people are so friendly, aren't they?
Yes, they are, and they mean it. It'll seem to me. Anyway, I don't doubt that they do. They may stop you in the street and chat. They're really pleased that I've come over, and I'm pleased that I was able to come because it's a great experience.
Well, I've only been here since yesterday, and Henry's already invited us to dinner, so that's pretty good, isn't it?
Good. Yeah. I mean, I haven't eaten here actually, but I know Jack and Derek all came up on Sunday. I was in the park eating ham and beans with the army, but they all came and had your Sunday lunch, and they said it was marvellous.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, thank you.
So that's highly recommended, certainly by the others in our party.
Well, mm-hmm. We're going to sneak off, I think, and have a look at the chef cooking this famous white asparagus, is that right?
Yeah, he's waiting for you.
How does he cook it? It was a secret.
In boiling water. It's not much of a secret to it. You have to start out as a good product. That's number one. And the asparagus that we import are what they call AAA quality, which is about the best quality available. And they cannot be undercooked and it cannot be overcooked. They have to be cooked just right, and the chef will show you how to do it.
Fantastic. Well, I'm going to go and do that, check it out, and perhaps you'll taste a bit later.
Oh, look forward to that. Mm-hmm.
I think while we're doing that, Claire's going to talk to your good wife, Beryl.
Fine.
A little chat, see how she's got on in the Andover. Yeah. Okay. All right, thanks for talking to us, Henry.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Ian, and we'll see you later.
Okay,
bye-bye. Well, what goes better with a beautiful Chablis than Andover Inn's White Asparagus Festival from May the 6th to June the 23rd? Look, everything is asparagus. Special white asparagus festival lunch and dinner menus. White asparagus in puff pastry boat, cream of white asparagus soup, white asparagus with potato and celery root salad, white asparagus, can't pronounce that, but white asparagus and tarragon dill, poached scallops, white asparagus with veal tenderloin and truffle sauce. Good heavens, let's go and see how it's cooked. Follow me. Follow me around the corner. There you go.
Hello, chef. This is Mr. Grindley.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm Buckle,
how
are you?
Tom?
Yeah.
How are you doing?
Very good, how are you?
I've heard all about this white asparagus.
Yes.
Henry's been telling me about it. This is fascinating. And there's so many items on your menu with white asparagus. Can you just tell me how you do it, or is it a big secret?
Well, we usually run a special, and this is our special promotion for the month of May and June, because it's traditionally the season for Europeans. We found that it works out very well for us, because we can we found a local supplier that can get it directly from Holland.
I've heard it's very, very good.
Very good. This first shipment that we got in was extremely good. The size was very nice. They were all fresh as could be, you know. Sometimes you get a little drying out of the product at the ends. But these were very, very nice.
So who works out the recipes with the puff pastry and the different ways you do it?
Basically, it's a little bit of myself, and also we have a couple of people that are from Holland here on a short-term basis to cook with us. And between the two of us, we can come up with a lot of different things.
Okay. Well, fine. Let me introduce you to the Mayor of Andover and the Test Valley, Councillor Ian Carr, Mayor of Andover. This is Tom, the chef.
Hello.
And we're going to just watch Tom doing this. So this is going to be absolutely fascinating. So over to the chopping board, I guess.
Yeah.
Right. What have we got here, Tom?
This is our white asparagus that's already been cooked for today. The way it starts out is the peel on this asparagus is rather thick, so we have to peel quite a bit of that off. Then we take the peelings and put them into a pan and cover it with some clean cloths.
Oh, I see. Right.
We let that cook down a little bit so we've got a nice flavor of the essence of the asparagus in the water. And then we put the asparagus spears gently into the water.
Oh, I see. So you peel it, you put that on the bottom, and then the cloth, right?
Right. And then we cover these again with cloth. That way they keep submerged in the hot liquid.
Mm-hmm.
And we keep it on a simmer. It takes about a half an hour for the asparagus to get cooked all the way through. It's a very, very precise procedure, because you'll see this one here has been just a little bit overcooked, and so it gets kind of on the limp side. If you get the perfect ones, this is how they are, just like that.
That's beautiful.
There's a nice texture to them. They're not overcooked or anything like that.
Did it take a lot of expertise to be able to do this? So you have to know exactly what you're doing, I guess.
A lot of practice, yes,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And this is the fourth year that I've been doing it, so I guess I've got 4 years of practice.
This is brilliant.
Yeah.
So what happens next? How do you serve them up now?
Okay. We also keep the same liquid now in service time, and it's kept at a low simmer. Mm-hmm. We put the portion of asparagus into the water, and it heats up just prior to when we serve it.
Mm-hmm.
And then we put it on the plates with whatever happens to be the dish that the guest has ordered. This time we've got a couple of side dishes, one with a hollandaise sauce, one with a parsley butter, and we've also got a nice cheese combination that we gratinate it.
Yep.
And for the main courses now, we've got the traditional limburgeoise, if I'm saying that.
That's very good.
Very good. With a boiled ham and hard-boiled eggs, chopped hard-boiled eggs on top of it.
I'd love to see one of these dishes. I presume that's hollandaise sauce over there, is it?
This is a different one of our sauces.
Oh, it's a different one of your sauces.
Yeah.
Okay.
We're just before service time, so we haven't got the hollandaise sauce made yet.
Right.
That's a sauce that needs to be made just moments before service and then held as minimal as possible because of the eggs in it.
Okay, you're just before service. Is there any chance of putting this on a plate to show us what it looks like? Or?
Oh, sure. Okay. Yeah, yeah. We can get one of the ham dishes together for you.
Yeah? Fantastic. This is really exciting, isn't it?
It's good.
Hi, well, now we're sitting with Beryl, our lovely mayoress of Andover, England. Beryl, tell me, the Americans seem so hospitable. Have they looked after you well?
Oh, wonderfully well, absolutely. They've been brilliant. They really have.
Where have you been?
Oh, it's been a whole week of a whirlwind activities. We've been to Boston, which was very interesting. We've been to a selectman meeting, which was an eye-opener. We had breakfast this morning with a Rotary Club at 7:15.
That's terribly early.
Very early. We've had pancakes in the street, a big street party.
And of course we saw your tennis this morning, and we've all been dying to know who won. So who won?
Do I have to answer that?
I think we know now. And you, when you went to Boston, you went on, you found out quite a lot about the history. Did you go on a trip there?
Yes, we did the Freedom Trail. We visited the old State House, and we learned all about the Boston Massacre and the Boston Tea Party. So it was
very informative. I mean, since I've been here, it's such a beautiful place, and the thing that really strikes you is the space, isn't it?
Wonderful, yes, and the houses seem so large, almost sort of like a Wendy house.
It really is so pretty here. So what else have you got planned before you go back?
Well, we have the banquet tomorrow night, which is really going to be the highlight of the visit, I think, whereby we're going to be there sitting on the same table as President Bush.
Wow, I know. And is he making a speech?
I believe so, yes. Yeah. So I think this is going to be a bit daunting, and this is going to be the highlight of the visit, definitely.
It really will be an amazing experience meeting him. Do you think you'll get a chance to talk to him?
Hopefully. I believe we will, yes. There's a reception before the banquet, and I believe we may have the opportunity then. So we're hoping.
That's very exciting. I do hope you get a chance to get back on that tennis court and try and settle that score. But thank you very much for speaking to us, and we'll see you again at the banquet tomorrow.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Right, well, the mayor's gone off to sit at the table with his wife, Beryl, and left me with Tom to see how this dish is going to be prepared. Now, Tom, do your best.
Okay. Actually, a lot of the preparation work has already been done. It makes it a lot simpler for the time of the service. The asparagus that we've had has been peeled and cooked. It takes a great deal of time and effort to get it to the right type of product, finished product that we want. I'm going to be doing a couple. The Limburgeoise, which is the traditional Dutch way of presenting it, and also a scallop dish.
Okay. So, right, it's up to you. I'll come around this side so Jason can see you there on camera.
Start with a little quick sauté of the scallops in a white wine.
Yep.
And meanwhile, I've got the asparagus already heating up for us. Mm-hmm. And I've got our potatoes and ham already.
Really?
I'll sneak behind you.
I'll come out the way. You go around there so we can get a good view of what's going on. Oh, this is the ham, right?
This is our boiled ham.
Yep. It looks absolutely delicious.
Slice it thin and then and cook it for a very brief amount of time. That way it doesn't get dried out.
Yep.
We do the three spears of asparagus, which we found is quite a bit for it.
Is that quite filling, I should think, isn't it? It's quite,
Mm-hmm. And then we have our boiled potatoes, which is also traditional for...
Boiled potatoes coming up. They look splendid as well.
And the very must is the drawn melted butter.
That's very important, isn't it, for asparagus?
Yes.
Even on the green ones back in England, we have the melted butter. Now the ham goes on.
And the ham goes on.
Yep.
Kind of fix the plate a little bit.
Cardboard eggs. Yep.
Which makes it the finishing touch. And a nice little mixture of chopped parsley.
Chopped parsley over the top of the hard-boiled eggs and over there.
It's a nice color contrast to the plate.
That's absolutely beautiful presentation, isn't it? That's wonderful. If you come around to that frying pan there, what's that around there?
We've got our scallops that have been simmering just briefly in some white wine. And the sauce that we've made is kept in the steam table, so it's warm. And we only want to cook that just enough to make sure that it's all nicely heated up. The scallops themselves will stay nice and plump.
Yep.
And very, very good.
So that's a white wine sauce.
White wine.
White wine sauce.
A little bit of tarragon and dill.
Tarragon and dill.
And then we do the same
another three
presentation with our asparagus and our boiled potatoes.
So you've got to be a real man to eat more than three asparagus tips. So there's three going on there.
Melted butter.
And I presume you can have more melted butter if you wanted, I guess.
Oh, yes.
That's right.
You can even have more asparagus if you'd like, too.
Really?
We have the sides of asparagus that we sell with the hollandaise sauce.
This looks really nice. I just love scallops. They are amazing.
These are local scallops.
They're local? Where'd they come from?
Just south of us, about 50 miles from the coast.
You're very strong for seafood in this part of the world, aren't you, really?
That's,
yes.
It's so much available.
Yep.
This is one of the biggest places in the country for the selling of seafood.
Okay.
And there's our second presentation. It's the scallops and the tarragon and parsley sauce.
Okay. Super. Okay, well, we're going to go into the restaurant now and watch the mayor of Andover and his wife, the mayoress, devour this. So we'll see you.
Okay.
We'll see you in the dining room. Follow us. There we go. I'm coming in with a waiter. There we are. Ian, I promised you a wonderful meal here at the Andover Inn. That's the asparagus with ham.
Oh, correct. Your meal.
And the
asparagus ham also.
Asparagus ham also.
The scallops are coming out in a moment.
Oh, you're having that one, aren't you?
Yeah, I might as well.
Well, nice. You can't eat, you own the place.
Take advantage of the situation, you know, so...
Anyway, I'm going to leave you in peace. Thank you so much for inviting us this afternoon. It's really, really splendid. And enjoy your asparagus. Enjoy the rest of your trip. We're off to the next assignment. We can't stop for food. Okay. So we'll see you later. Bye for now. Thank you, Henry. Bye-bye.
Well, as you see, Al and crew have been over in America. The weather was bad over there. The weather's been quite good here, and we were invited down to Wiltshire, a beautiful part of Wiltshire, to have a look at Farmer Giles' farmstead. I'm going to show you some of this now. Next week we'll show you more of it. We had a wonderful day there. So, Andover, Massachusetts, Andover here, Salisbury, Wiltshire. When the sun shines, it's great here. Well, I hope you enjoyed that. As I say, next week we're going to show you a lot more of that, and I know you're going to enjoy it. Hey, here's Al back from America. Welcome back.
Good morning. Good morning.
Here, take your usual stance.
Good heavens. Good heavens. At least the weather's better here.
Yes, it is.
It rained.
Nah.
Rained for 4 days, day and night. And it actually stopped at 5 o'clock just before we can to leave to catch the old BA flight back to London. Never mind. Great fun. Anyway, where are we? Last week's competition. In my absence, thousands of you have rung in.
Thousands.
And they weren't too difficult, the answers, were they? The first one was helicopter, and the second one was the Army Air Corps. So where's that golden bucket? We've got four tickets to Wallop. And we've got a £50 voucher from Foster's to give away this week if you are the winner.
The thing is, nobody got this wrong. Nobody phoned in with the wrong answer.
Well, you didn't have Concords in the middle of the wallet, do you? Or jumbo don't. Jets. But anyway.
Go on. Back in the old routine.
Back in the old routine. This is a Salisbury number. And Tracy Dodge, you've won 4 tickets to Middle Wallop for the International Air Show. Great family day out. VIP tickets, you're going to be treated like royalty. And you won a £50 voucher from Foster's. And that's in Andover. That's Tracy Dodge, is a Salisbury number. Well done, Tracy. Thanks for ringing in. Thanks for all of you ringing in. It's really gratifying when so many people ring in. What's this week's competition? Oh, I know. We've got some prizes as well. We've got 3 exclusive Virgin T-shirts. But first, we've got 3 computer games as well. I'll show you those in just a minute. But what we're going to do now is run you a bit of film we shot yesterday at the new Virgin store opening in, where is it, the old George Mill?
In Salisbury, yes.
The old George Mill in Salisbury. And Spire FM were there. We were there. It was packed out. And all these people were singing a great hit. And we're going to run this right now. And we want to know who sang this. So I'll just nip off and get the prizes. Who sang this? Right, well, we can have 3 winners for this week's competition. As I say, who sang that? Now, the 3 winners will receive one of these Duke Newcomers. It's a brand new computer game, plus an exclusive Virgin sweatshirt. These are really nice. These are really exclusive. I don't think you can buy them in the shops yet. They're really, really nice. So each of the 3 winners will receive those. The first one out of the Golden Bucket next week will also get another 4 VIP tickets to the Middle Wallop International Air Show. So that's a fantastic prize.
It'll be a great day, that.
So who sang that record you just heard? That was dead easy. Female American? Oh, dear. Oh, dear. Anyway, we've had a great...
You've got America on the brain this week.
America's on the brain, yeah. I never met her over there, though. And anyway, we met President Bush, well, the former President George Bush, in Andover, Massachusetts. And we were just about to go and film him. Very, very tight security. And the Secret Service wander around everywhere. These little bits in like this. And we're talking through their wherever, you know. And they very heavy-looking characters.
Guns.
And they said to us, hang on a minute. They said, you can't go in there dressed like that, to Jason.
What did he have on it?
He had jeans and a sweatshirt on. But, of course, it was President Bush. And I suppose got to observe protocol. So
as one does, doesn't one?
We thought, what are we going to do? So Charles from TCI Cable said, we better get down to Mr. Tux. Mr. Tux. And can you believe, on a Saturday morning, you can whiz down to Mr. Tux. And for $70, they will kit you out in everything, from shoes to shirt to bow tie, the whole lot. So
poor old Jay had to wear that.
You're going to see this coming up right now. So we took the camera into Mr. Tux. Great time. Then he left to go and film former President George Bush with the mayor of the Test Valley. And that was really great. So that is coming up right now. And you'll see it on the show next week, the actual meeting, shaking hands with the president. So it was absolutely brilliant.
I haven't seen that. I'm looking forward to seeing this.
So am I. It's just been a nightmare these last few days. But anyway, we're back. Thanks for watching Town TV. Watch more of the Andover, Massachusetts show next week and the week after. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.